He goes,
thank you.
All right. No, thank you so much. Jazakum khairan, and thank you. All right. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Okay. So today, inshallah, we're going to talk a little bit about motherhood. This is so funny. Sorry. All right. About motherhood and how dear she is and her importance. Okay. Not just our mothers, but us as mothers. Okay. And I'm not going to tell you mothers is what you need to do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Not today. Okay. Or you need to do this or you need to do that. I want to focus on your importance. So the importance of your role, okay? So when I come and tell you this is what you have to do, you'll take it to heart and try to really change to the better, inshallah, okay? When you know how important you are and what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala assigned you to, okay? You're something great. You're beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The day you won the title mother, you were put in a very, very high rank. You're a mother. And I would like to start by describing what a mother's compassion is like. If I were to ask you, what is the greatest title that was ever given to anyone over the different eras, after the prophets, that is, of course. What's the greatest title? A general, or a president, or a leader, a doctor, or an engineer, father-in-law, son-in-law, husband, or a mother? Think about it. Put all these titles together and put in front of them the title mother. And see what is the dearest title in humanity. The dearest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A title that has traveled through history. If you think about it, the title doctor, not say anything. How long since has it been used? How long has it existed for as a terminology between us? Or engineer, or even a president? Which is dearer? Okay, let me tell you something else that can make you understand what a mother is and who she is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's names, right? And it's one of the dearest names to Him. And we would be doomed if it were not for this name. And our lives and our afterlife would end in a terrible way. And there's not a surah in the Quran unless it begins with this name, except one. What is that name? Or these names? Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim. The beneficent, the most merciful. Right? This name that we love so much and our destiny is tied to it, right? If we didn't have Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's rahmah, you know, none of us would enter Jannah, basically. Because, yeah, we could do so good, but at the end, we still enter with His what? With His mercy, with His rahmah. Okay? So, the beneficent, the most merciful. This name that we love so much, our destiny is tied to. So, in order for us to feel this word in this life, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala embodies it for you in the form of your mother in this world. So, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created mercy, He divided it into how many parts? 100 parts. He sent down to earth 1 part. Okay, all the rahmah that you see on this earth, from mothers to children and animals, any kind of rahmah that you see on this life, okay? Okay, I'm sorry, let me just stop. Sweethearts, sweeties, I'm sorry, can you go to the other room? Is that okay? Thank you. Thank you. All right. I'm sorry. Okay, so all the rahmah that you see here on this earth is only 1 part out of the 100 parts that we're talking about. And He subhanahu wa ta'ala kept 99 parts till the day of judgment. And then He joins that 1 part to the 99 on the day of judgment, and He spreads it over His creation. So can you imagine what these 99 parts are? Or this 1 part that every single creation has mercy with it towards one another? So if you see 1 part, you see all the rahmah, like how many, you know, you see even a kitten, like, you know, trying to clean her little, you know, or a cat cleaning her kitten, or, you know, whatever, how you always see the elephant mother with her little baby, subhanAllah, or us with our, you know, with our little ones. And all of this, from the beginning of creation till the day of judgment, is just one rahmah, one piece of His mercy. So how would the 99 parts be like? Okay? So if you want to picture or understand even that 1 part, look at your mother, or look at yourself as a mother. SubhanAllah. The example of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy that He has embodied or materialized for us to see is someone very close to you, through which you can see His mercy. That's your mother, or that is you, as a mother now. And the Prophet says this too. Look at her mother carrying her baby in the scorching heat, and she keeps trying to shelter her baby with her own body, not caring what happens to herself, as long as her baby has the shade to protect him. So the Prophet, peace be upon him, looks at her and says to the companions, can you picture this lady throwing her son in hellfire? So the companions replied, oh no, Messenger of Allah. So he replied, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is more merciful to you than that lady is to her baby. SubhanAllah. Your mother is that walking mercy. You are that walking mercy. Look at what your mother has done with you since you were born, and try to picture what His mercy is like with you. And I want to point out something very important here. The day you have become a mother, you have become life proof of His mercy. SubhanAllah. You're life proof. That's why our dua is accepted. No one can make dua for your child and have those gates of heaven open for him other than you. Because you're one of those 100 parts. SubhanAllah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created a lot of mercies, right? The sun is a sign of His mercy. Water is a sign of His mercy. The air we breathe is a mercy. But all these mercies are what? Silent mercies. So He subhanahu wa ta'ala created a speaking personal mercy for each one of us that accompanies us night and day, through which you can be acquainted to His mercy subhanahu wa ta'ala. And He subhanahu wa ta'ala prepares us as mothers in a way that no one else can be like, not even men. From the day you get pregnant, the way you are set up is a way that no other being can handle. For example, who would let anyone feed on their own body's sustenance and take from their own minerals and calcium and food to survive? And above that, you accept willingly. Where did this mercy come from? That I agree my body would be taken from it on a daily basis. My blood would be taken from it and I would be happy and willing. So from the minute you carry that baby and tolerate the pains and the nausea and the contractions, SubhanAllah, you're a sign of His mercy. You're an embodied mercy. And that's why the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ says, with the first contraction, all her sins are forgiven. Can you imagine you coming to give labor or to give birth with a mountain of sins? We all have sins. No one's just, you know, pure, unless you're repenting on a daily basis, inshallah. And with that first minute, you're honored with the title mother, and the first contraction hits, all your sins are forgiven. SubhanAllah. Never thought of that before. And the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ says, I'd be entering the prayer, and my intention is to elongate. Prayer is beautiful. So I hear a baby crying. I start speeding up my prayer out of mercy on his mother and her compassion towards her baby. Salaam alaikum, how are you doing? The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam had great appreciation to the feelings of a mother. Now, do you know the story of the Prophet Sulaiman, peace be upon him, with the two ladies? When he found two ladies who each had a baby, and the wolf ate one of the babies, and the two ladies were screaming and crying, of course. So one of the ladies said, this baby is mine. And the other said, no, it's my baby. The wolf ate your baby. And they started arguing. So they went to Prophet Dawood alayhi salam, and he judged that the baby was the older lady's. So Prophet Sulaiman was passing by and he asked them, what's wrong? So they told him what happened. So he replied what? Sayyidina Sulaiman replied saying what? There's absolutely no problem. We will bring a knife and slit the baby in half, and each one of you can get a half. Bring a knife quickly. One of the ladies screamed, no, may Allah have mercy on you. He's her son, I'm lying. Sulaiman replied, he's your son. Sulaiman knew that this compassion would come out only from a mother, subhanAllah. And he ruled that the baby belongs to the younger lady who said that this son is not mine, because she's so scared, she's so worried about her own son, subhanAllah. And a verse of the Quran comes down about the saying what? فَفَهَّمْنَاهَا سُلَيْمَانَ. We made Sulaiman understand the compassion of a mother, subhanAllah. That's how he understood. He knew that the one that would really fear for the death of her son was the one who was going to speak out, not the other one who cared just about having a child. You're very dear to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ says about a mother raising her child, she has the reward of the one who is praying all night while fasting. لَهَا أَجْرِ الصَّائِمِ الْقَائِمِ. So all the carrying and the whining and the waking up 100 times during the night and the lack of sleep that we talk about is like you are fasting all day and praying all night, subhanAllah. How many children do you have? Yes, two. How many years have you gone through this with each one of them? Now sit down and calculate. Do you see where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put you? Your caring for your children and raising them is fasting and praying all night. Can you imagine? Which person can fast and pray for 4 or 5 years consecutively? Who can get up every single day for 5 years or 4 years, Qiyam Layl? Tell me about one person other than the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Even when he used to fast one day and break his fast one day. Or he used to fast Mondays and Thursdays. But fasting every day and getting up every day in the middle of the night to do Qiyam Layl, who gets that reward, subhanAllah? Motherhood. Something honored in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says what? فَأَوْحَيْنَا إِلَىٰ أُمِّ مُوسَىٰ أَنْ أُرْدَعِيهِ فَإِذَا خِفْتِ عَلَيْهِ فَأَلْقِيهِ فَالْيَمْ. Saying what? So we sent this inspiration to the mother of Moses saying, suckle him or nurse him. Then, once you fear about him, cast him where? Into the river, right? But if you think about it, why was the scene of nursing even mentioned or described in the Quran? Isn't the main theme here when we're talking about the story of Fir'aun is what? If you're afraid, throw him into the river, right? Wasn't that the whole concept? If you're worried about your son, throw him. But why was the other phrase even stated? Because this scene, subhanAllah, this great shot had to be mentioned in the Quran. The scene of the mother nursing her child. SubhanAllah, something, if you think about it, the whole story is talking about, you know, Sayyidina Fir'aun and how he saw, you know, he knew that somebody was going to come and overtake him, and so he decided to kill all the boys, you know, and then say, you know, and Musa had a boy. So why would, you know, amid all of this, it's like, okay, nurse the baby, but then if you're afraid for him, throw him into the river, subhanAllah. You think about it because it's showing you how great what you're doing is, okay? And why all of this? Because you impersonate his mercy on earth again, as we said in the beginning. And because of you, humanity can sit and picture what the other 99 parts of mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would be like. We were just saying, sister, in the beginning that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has 100 mercies and he only sent down one part. All the mercy that we see on this earth is out of this one part. And it was embodied to us in the form of a mother, in form of you or your mother, subhanAllah. So you'd be able to picture what the other 99 parts are of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he is going to what show us on the day of judgment, inshaAllah. Now I want to point something else. Now a different idea. It's a little bit weird, but just bear with me. And that is basically you're the lab of this life. Okay, what does that mean? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created what? Adam and Eve with his own hands. He says what? قَالَ يَا إِبْلِيسَ مَا مَنَعَكَ أَن تَسْجُدَ لِمَا خَلَقْتُ بِيَدِي. Oh Iblis, what has prevented you from bowing down to what I have created with my own hands? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created you what? With his own hands, okay? Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destined for the family to be with his command. And through it, the continuity of what? Of reproduction or creation on earth. See the family again, or the importance of family again here. And then he appointed the mother what does the father do, basically? Or what is the job of the father? You know, all his job is to place what? The sperm in the mother's uterus, right? That's it. That's his whole job. But you're the mother, you're the laboratory or the workshop of the life. You're carrying the responsibility of the continuation of humanity, subhanAllah, if you think about it. Do you understand the magnitude of the mission assigned to you by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The permanence of this earth depends on you as a mother. You are very dear to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why every month you have to go through ovulation, and hormones, and pains, and cramping. It's the mission of creation going in you every single month, subhanAllah. It's such a huge thing if you think about it. The mission of creation is taking place in you. You're like a moving lab, if you think about it, really, subhanAllah. So the menstrual cycle can be looked upon very differently now. It's not an impurity. And don't touch her, like some people, you know, are backwards, back home, they're like, oh, don't touch her, you know. And you have this concept till now, subhanAllah. And that's why the Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu, when he went to Medina, he found the Jews of Medina saying what? That if a lady has her menstrual cycle and she touches anything, it becomes what? Impure. That's what their understanding was, sorry. So he wanted to change this concept. And he would recite the Quran in Aisha's lap when she had her menstrual cycle. And to convey a clear message to us. And when she had her menstrual cycle and she would drink from a cup, he would look for the place where she put her lips on and he would drink from the same spot that she what drank from, right, subhanAllah. And once he asked his wife, Salama, to hand him something. And she replied, but I am impure, you know, I'm not praying. So he replied, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and is the impurity in your hands? You are pure. It's a part of the mission that you're assigned to, subhanAllah. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he says naqusatu deen, like they're lacking religion, he can never mean what most people impose these days, and that is you lack religion, you don't have a proper religion, no. It means you have less days of worshipping, less fasting and less praying. Not a negative lacking off, as people say it. Naqusatu aql, like they have a lack of brain and religion. You know how some people convey that. So why don't we pray and fast? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has assigned to you a universal mission. And in front of it, he removed a mission of legitimacy, a mission of praying and fasting. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is just. And if he assigns you something, he has to enlighten another burden off from you, subhanAllah. And at the end, everybody ends up carrying much the same, both genders, men and women. Okay? And actually, subhanAllah, you have more rights than the man. You know, by his justice and by honoring you to do this mission, subhanAllah. So those who say Islam has oppressed women, I'll tell them what, here you go. why didn't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give this role to men? You know, if it was such an important thing, and you think to yourself that you have this mission in you every single month, it's a workshop of humanity, creation, Khalifatullah being vicegerent of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's earth, then why didn't he give it to men? Or why did he say that they were, you know, they lack religion? They don't. It's a lacking of the time of your worshipping because you have something more important to do, or something just as is important to do. And it's your duty to instill this in your idea in your daughters as they grow, that they're very dear to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they have to learn how to honor that by protecting and preserving themselves, subhanAllah. And also to instill it in our sons as they grow, how to honor the mission that is assigned to the people who are going to become their better halves, inshallah, or their other halves. And never to trespass their limits in dealing with girls. To know how to honor that, subhanAllah, okay? And subhanAllah, a girl from when she's little, she gets prepared and loaded with that compassion till she grows. And one day becomes what? A mother. And that's why psychiatrists explain to you why a girl, gets so engrossed in, you know, playing with a doll, and she wants to dress her up, and she wants to, you know, feed her and bathe her and put her to sleep. SubhanAllah, she's being prepared. And there was this trend going on in the States around the 60s, subhanAllah, you know, there's no difference, men and women are the same, and what's the problem with men staying home and women going to work, and let the men raise the kids, you know, and all this pressure from all the different women's organizations, and we need liberation, and woman doesn't have, you know, have her rights, and she's oppressed, and this and that. To the extent that they started actually forcing toy stores here in the States to no longer have aisles designated specifically for boys and aisles for girls, because that's called, you know, differentiating between genders, which shouldn't be done. And they kept pushing on this idea until toy companies say they lost millions of dollars, because the kids would go, the boys would go, and it's just too confusing for them, subhanAllah, and the girls the same thing. Until modern science proved that the actions of the embryo of a female inside the uterus is different from that of a male, subhanAllah. And then articles started being published to correct the idea that they're not the same, there's a difference, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would have just had one gender. Why is there a man and why is there a woman, subhanAllah? And then things started going back to normal again, and that's why, you know, you go to Toys R Us, you have, alhamdulillah, a girl's aisle, you have a boy's aisle, you have, you know, toddler's aisle, whatever it is, it makes it even easier, you know. So why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give mothers all this ability to have compassion? Because if you think about it, without this compassion, this whole world would be doomed. Because if you picture a baby being born, and there's no such thing as a mother to care for him, you gave birth, and between your hands is a little piece of flesh that totally depends on you. They don't know anything other than you, okay? They know nothing in this world. Now imagine if you had no compassion or mercy in your heart. What's going to happen? What could have happened to humanity, not just to your baby? You're the most important part of humanity. You have to understand that. You are the most important of humanity. You have such a huge role assigned to you by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The existence of humanity depends on you, on your compassion as a mother, subhanAllah. It depends on you. And this compassion, when you show to your kids, subhanAllah, it fills their hearts and then they show back to you again. Believe me, sometimes we feel like, you know, we're always just kind, we're always giving, and our kids, subhanAllah, they go through their phases, whether they're little, when they have their tantrums, or they're going through their teenage years and they're having their, you know, their emotional, you know, roller coaster, you know. So subhanAllah, eventually, it does eventually kick in, subhanAllah, because you can't plant roses and then have, you know, onions coming out. If you plant roses, you'll have roses. If you plant, you know, onions, you'll find onions, subhanAllah. So whatever you keep putting in them, one day, inshallah, it's going to come out. You just have to have the patience in you, subhanAllah. And you have to always give it with the compassion. And you'll see later on how the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, whenever he came to instruct a child or give them any kind of piece of advice, it was always with either a rub on the shoulder or on the head or a little pat. You know, if he's telling them something, instructing them, it would be in a way while he was what? Being compassionate. Because if I come and tell you, go put away your clothes. I was like, okay, honey, can you please go away, put away your clothes? That little touch, subhanAllah, does miracles. If you yourself, if you're, you know, your child comes and hugs you or your husband comes and pats you, versus when he comes and tells you something just like that, the perception of it is very different to you, right or wrong. SubhanAllah, you take it in a very different way. And the same thing with our kids. And we have to be very careful with that. Try to give a lot of compassion. Just make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you the ability to have that compassion, because we get tired, it's very difficult. It's very difficult. You know, we have this cycle of vicious cycle of life. It's a vicious cycle of life. You want to get home, you want to make sure their homework is done, you want to make sure that they prayed, you want to make sure that their clothes are ready for the next day, you want to make sure that dinner is ready, you want to make sure that their clothes are ironed, and your clothes are ironed, and that everything is clean before you go to sleep. So everyone's like, let's go, like you're rushing, and then this one's slacking back on this one, and this is taking her time, I don't know, doing what, or this one's having a tantrum or not listening. And at the end you find yourself, your voice is this big, subhanAllah. I mean, it happens to all of us. But you just have to keep breathing and thinking to yourself, you know what, just take the time. Kids need the time. They really do. And I'm saying this to myself before you. You know, we need to just step back and take a deep breath. You know, it's not the kid's fault that they have to do this and this and this and that. You know, and it's not nice to have the child always in that pressured atmosphere, which always ends up happening. You know, with all our demands of life. It's not really theirs. If you think about it, you want them to have this done by that, and you want them to have this done by... It's not what they really need necessarily, but it's because this is what we need to do, because you need to put them to bed, because you want to have time to do this and this and that. And subhanAllah, they end up being like rushed. So how are they going to have this compassion back for us if we don't give them that compassion, subhanAllah? So you have to step back and really try. Try to go back home and do it today. You know, even... Try. Try, give them a hug. I know, finish your homework. Believe me, I did the same thing on the phone. I haven't seen them yet, but I did the same thing. But, you know, we just have to really try to, you know, take a step back, because it doesn't make any good. The more stress we put, subhanAllah, it just builds more negative energy in the home. Yeah. It doesn't do any good. They do. And they feel like they're being pushed and shoved around. And, you know, I know they have to learn how to manage their time. But I think it's just make a lot of dua and just, you know, patience. Just patience, make dua for yourself and for them. You know, make dua for yourself that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you patience and compassion, you know, with them. Because that's what they need. They need patience, time, compassion. And then miracles work, subhanAllah, inshaAllah. All right? So, and then if you think about it, from the first minute, subhanAllah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants you the ability to decode your baby's first cry. A father would stand there knowing what to do. And I'm sure all of you remember when you first had your children. And you very confidently say, no, he just needs to change, or he needs to burp, oh no, he needs to nap, or something's hurting him, it's just probably his ear, he's been pulling it, it's probably his ear, or whatever it is, okay? And you can get the most patient man on earth, I'm telling you, and wake him up out of his sleep 3 times, all right, because the baby's crying. What's going to happen? The first time, like, okay, he'll go. Second time, he'll go with a huff, and then the third, I was like, okay, your child is not raised, here's your child, and then he goes and bunks outside on the couch, right? He's like, I don't have to deal with you, you don't know how to raise the baby, like the baby's even 2 days old, you know? But they don't have, subhanAllah, Allah didn't give them, it's not something bad about them, it's just, they were not created with that patience, not created, subhanAllah, they were not created with it. So basically, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has this heavenly secret in you. It's created with you. A secret that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed in you that no man can explain or imitate. It's just that that's the way it is. It's not something that we chose to be like, or we're saying, oh, we're better than you in this or that. It's just the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us. And if you look at men, any man in general, they can only focus on one mission at a time. Meaning what? There's a man who's a teacher, there's a man who's a driver, or a man who's a doctor, or a man who's a professor, or a tailor, or a chef, whatever. But there is no man that can be all these things at the same time. Look around you. You won't find them. Maybe rare, one or two. But the norm, the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that a man can be focused on one mission at a time. But you as a mother, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's will, and by that secret that He put in you, you can accomplish all these things at the same time. You're the teacher. You're the Arabic teacher, and the English teacher, and the math, and the science if you have to. You're a great doctor assistant. Your pediatrician gives you instructions, you go back home and you follow every single instruction without the slightest mistake. You're a chef, great chef, hopefully. Well, I'm not gonna say I am, I'm not a good chef, but I cook. Okay, you're a laundromat, you're a tailor, you're a driver, you're a professor in raising and understanding the psychology of your child, and a great wrestler. If someone comes and tries to touch your child, you turn into that beast that could, you know, knock down 10 men, subhanAllah. What are you? SubhanAllah, think about it. What are you? You are the secret of His mercy on this earth. That's what you are. Do you understand now why the reward of the fasting, praying all night? Because you can do all these things at the same time. How many of you do, you can multitask, can't you? Every mother I have seen on earth she can be doing a million things. She's cooking while she put the first load of the laundry in the, you know, in the whatever, and she's, I don't know, you know, the vacuum's running, I don't know what, where, and her son is, she's following his homework and preparing the lunches for the next day. You can do a million things at the same time and thinking in your head what you're going to be planning for the next day for the kids from whatever activities and what they're wearing and what's ready and what's not ready. A million things that you can be doing. At the same time, you're listening to their arguments and correcting them, you know, or trying to tell them, you know, this is the way to deal with this, or this is what you should be doing. SubhanAllah, how can you think about it? It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's ability to make you have the mercy in you. So people can see what mercy is, and then they can picture His mercy subhanahu wa ta'ala. So another story that I would want to share with you, there was a mother and her son was diagnosed with something. It was very, very, like, he was in intensive care, but no visitors were allowed, no touching. Now if you come and tell a father, you know, you can't touch your son, you know, it's different when you tell a mother, you can't touch your son when they're sick. So this mother was literally, she was going crazy, she was going insane, like, how can I not touch my son? Like, my son is ill, and if she touches him, she's going to get sick herself, you know. So she sat thinking, she'd be standing behind the glass watching her son for hours and hours, and she wants to communicate with him, subhanAllah, in any sense, until she came up with an idea, and she bought a torch, two torches. And what they did was they totally sanitized it, and they gave it to the boy inside, the nurses, and she held one from outside. And she would keep flickering the light to him, and he would flicker the light to her, and playing together, subhanAllah, just so that they would have, she would have that feeling that I'm actually communicating with my son. Like, I'm not really touching him, but the lights that we're both holding, subhanAllah, are touching each other. Mm-hmm. SubhanAllah. Alhamdulillah, he got fully cured after that, but just something that I thought was very, you know, very sweet. And there was another, like, recent, you know, it's not recent, it's something over the times that all children, you know, how they come now tell you, you know, baby, you shouldn't hold the baby, you're going to get him used to being carried and let them cry themselves out to sleep and whatever. They've come now that kids who are raised without being held and touched are kids that grow up to be definitely depressed. SubhanAllah. Mm-hmm. And that's why, again, I can relate to the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, how every time he would instruct a child, it would be what? He's holding him, patting him, or rubbing him on his head, subhanAllah, because he knew the effect of me just telling you something versus me doing it when I'm touching you. You know what I'm saying? SubhanAllah. So that's it, you know, basically it. So if you think about it, you know, how do you do all these things? If you sit and think about it, it doesn't make any sense. Sometimes people ask me, you know, how are you teaching? I was like, don't ask me, it just happens. I have no idea. Don't ask me, because if I sit and think about it, sit and write it, you're going to think, okay, this is insane, subhanAllah. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because He willed for the continuity of humanity to depend on you, therefore, He, you know, He gave you or He granted you the ability to perform all these tasks at the same time. Again, because you embody His mercy on this earth, subhanAllah. So that's it for today. Questions, please. Ideas, sharing something.
I was thinking the same thing, like, how does she do it when you put your sketches, mashallah, on Facebook?
Oh, these were old. These were before I had kids.
How does she do it?
That was from the days of the college. Don't worry.
Amazing.
Oh, you saw my drawings too? Oh, yeah. Yeah,
it was fun. Start teaching after school.
I'm trying actually to cut back on everything, Allahu Akbar, because I really want to spend more time with my kids. I just feel very, yeah, I feel very, they, I mean, I feel like very, it's not fair to them. Like, they're not going to need me as much later. They will need me in other ways, but now, you know, I just feel like they need this time, yani. You know, so I'm trying to cut back on it as things, yes, please. I'm trying to cut back as many as things as I can, unfortunately. But inshallah, when they grow a bit older, inshallah, yeah, inshallah, inshallah, yeah. Inshallah. I feel bad.